afternoon, everybody. I am very happy to have such a large turnout. I hope there's no fire hazard. I would just like to say a warm welcome to everyone. We are going to take you behind the scenes of a project we started in 1997, at the end of 1997. My friend Mario Miranda made me research one garment called the Panbaju that I had never seen. And he said, why don't you do the research on this topic? And I did the research. It was for a book by Mario Cabral, Lisa. And unfortunately, the book did not see the light of day, but after 3 months of research, I enjoyed the project so much that I said to myself, as a lecturer of world costume history, that I would I should be able to do all the costume of Goa for a book. And then eventually what happened was I started the research, and then when the research started, it took 10 years to finish, and finally 1 year to write the book. In the process, I did not know anything about garments, and I decided that I had to learn Portuguese, because all the records were in Portuguese. So I learned Portuguese in 1 month, thanks to my friend Ishmania Venkati. I don't know whether she's here. And I went off to Lisbon. I did an internship for 3 months at the Museu Nacional do Traje, in the Costume Museum. And then I went to New York and I studied under Valerie Steele, one of the great curators of the world. In both museums, I learned different things. In one museum, I learned how to deal with older garments that were mainly till the 20th century. And in the other museum, I did garments that were from the 21st century. And then I came back to India, and we finally, HarperCollins published the book. When the book was being published, in that 10-year period, I began to collect garments and accessories and gold and everything. And I began to think that maybe this was a good idea now to put it into a museum. At that time, I had no idea that I was going to be the first costume museum in the country, until it was brought to my notice by the Ministry of Culture and the Ministry of Textiles, who are helping us in the project in many ways. We decided we would move out of our big house. Here we were two gay men living in a big house with four dogs that were occupying the bedrooms. So we moved out of the house, and we are now living in a much smaller house. And we are giving this museum as a legacy to Goa and India. So I'm going to start with my first slide. So this is a book that Mario Miranda made me write. It was very nice to see, the coffee table book. It took me all over Goa. We photographed everything that we possibly could. We had to write to many museums for photographs to get for the book. And eventually, when the book came out, it was launched in Goa by Rosemary Klim of the Victoria and Albert Museum, who has now since retired. Next slide, please. So this was our house, as it was at that time when it was a house. And now it looks completely different. Next slide. So we had to plan the interiors. We took on the experts in the field. We took on ECA services that are that is one of the best museum experts in the country. Deepthi Shashidran came in and advised us at every stage. We realized that we had to, the museum was beyond what I had imagined and what I had studied in both New York and in Lisbon. We thought, okay, fine, we're going to shut all the walls and doors, which we had never shut in 25 years in that house. I said, we'll close it all, we'll air condition it up, and then we'll display it. Well, it was not to be like that. 5.5 lakhs crores later, we are still missing a couple of crores, which we hope we will collect. And but we want to get an international Committee of Museum certification, because that will help us a lot to get objects from other museums internationally and for us to lend them collections as well. Now, to get that certificate, we had to do many things. We had to we later on added a research center, because we did not want the museum just to be a museum, but we wanted scholars to come there, we wanted students to come. And we actually, in the phase two, which we haven't yet started, we are going to have a scholar's residence. We have storage. We did not the two museums, one in Lisbon and the other one in New York, they had one big difference, and that was the conservation department, which was in New York and in Lisbon. But in Lisbon, they had a department called the restoration department. And when I went to New York, Valerie Steele told me, she said, "Wendell, please do not cancel that department of restoration, because you cannot restore old garments. Leave them in their original way, because the minute you introduce new threads, the minute you introduce new fibers or new gold threads, then you are going to ruin the existing garment. So some of the garments that we have are torn, and some of them have been mended, but we are very happy to keep them in that state. We are going to lay them all out flat. We are not going to have, apart from the garments that we can reproduce, everything is going to be laid out flat, because they discovered somewhere after I finished my research that the force of gravity is equal to the speed of light, and if we hang them, then we are going to get all the seams ripped, and we have to keep them lying down, so every 3 months they will change. Towards that end, I'm going to lead you now through the galleries that we have. So the plan of the galleries, this is this section up to here is what we have completed. I'm happy to say that the architects are in this room. Arvind and Nita are in this room. And we had also a lighting director who came in, Lyle, from Delhi. We have a display director. And on our board of trustees, we had Amitabh Ghosh. We have the jeweler to the court of Mysore, Sri Devi Deshpande Puri, Praja Sakatande, who may be here. Yes, to guide us along the history part. And myself. So this part of the museum we are going to do later after we open that section, which we are hoping, fingers crossed. We've had a lot of problems trying to meet deadlines, but so far Arvind has done a great job. Thank you. Next slide, please. And the next one. So you will enter into what is called Gallery 1, which is the reception or the orientation room. Next, please. We don't have anything in this room except one mashila, which was in all old Goan houses to carry the landlords all over the village or to see their fields. And the mashila normally is in the reception room of most old houses. We kept it there as an accessory, because it was an accessory that was used till about the 20th century. Now, in this room, we also have a map. We have maps, old maps of Goa, that's old Goa. We also have a map of India, and we have a dedication that explains about the museum. The next gallery is called Evolution. For this, I had called my good friend Devdutt Patnaik, being many years ago when we were doing the research for the book. And Devdutt Patnaik advised me about the gods. I didn't know much about Hindu gods, I must say. And I had to learn a lot, but now I can teach some Goan Hindus about their own gods. I learned so much from Devdutt. He came and stayed with us for 4 days, and in those 4 days he was asking questions to, like, you know, we would call the butt of the pandit at the Shanta Durga temple and say, can you tell us what is Shanta Durga sitting on? And they didn't know, can you imagine? So they said, well, she's sitting on something, but she's all dressed up in the sari, and we don't know. So we asked basic questions. Is she on a tiger? Is she on a shaman who sit on stage? Or is she sitting on a lion? So then finally we found out that that she was sitting on a lion, unlike the rest of India, where she sits on a tiger. In this grand process of learning things, I realized that our Goan gods are very different from the rest of India. For example, Krishna appears as very happy playing with the gopis god in the rest of India, but in Goa he comes in his Kshatriya avatar to come and slay the Narkasur. And so he is very, very different, and he is the reason why we celebrate Diwali the next day. Because after that slaying happens, as for those who know, Vaishnavites and Shivites celebrate Diwali in different ways. The Shivites are celebrating the return of Ram to Ayodhya, whereas we are celebrating the killing of the Narkasur. So I had to learn all this, which I had no idea about. Next, please. So we start from prehistoric. This is a mother goddess. Some people at the Goa University feel that it's a man. I don't know how a man can have a vagina, but we let her have the benefit of doubt. In charge of the history department at the Goa University. We start from very early mother goddess period. Next slide, please. This is Devdutt Patnaik's sketch of all the gods in Goa. We start with Vaman, who appears as the first Brahmin, and then we go all the way down until we come to Vishnu. For us in fashion and in weaving, if you go to Kanchipuram especially, you will see a lot of Vishnu statues, because the threads of weaving come out from his navel, like it's drawn in that in this lying down state of the god Vishnu. So we had to, I did not know, but then Devdutt Patnaik explained to me everything. This, the original that he drew, is going to be in the museum, and we've blown up an entire frame of this painting on the ceiling, so when you look up, we can have the guide explain to you from the ceiling rather than the painting, which is on one wall. Next, please. So this is Shanta Durga. You all know the story of Shanta Durga and how important she is in the Kumkoli temple, where they killed some priest who came to convert the village. And when they killed those priests, the Portuguese said, "We are going to come and now destroy your temple and the village." And they came there, but they managed to spirit away the idol. The idol was taken away. Shanta Durga is very unusual. Now they have a Kumkoli festival called Sontriyo, where they have 12 umbrellas that they go to the sheem of the village, to Fatorda. They pick up the idol from the temple and they bring her back to Kumkoli, where they have a puja, where the Catholic priest and the Hindu priest both venerate her, and then she's taken back. Now, in this temple also, what is unusual about Shanta Durga is the fact that everywhere else in India she appears as a warrior, but in Goa she appears in the Shant state, because Shiva tells her, "You are very angry, or you are fighting and you are going to war. Please go to Goa and relax and chill." A lot of people do it today. So she appears in dreams. She appears in dreams and she asks for children, she asks for houses, and she asks for saris. And we are very happy to say that those saris are auctioned once in a way, and they are bought, and people, the priests don't know the value of these expensive Kanjivarams and Maharashtrian saris that are filled with gold. They sell them for little or nothing. We are very lucky, we have managed to get two saris for our museum, which are blessed by the statue, and they will be there. Next, please. So the third gallery, which is the most difficult gallery for us, because every month I keep hearing about new people that visited and touched Goa. This melting pot, next. This melting pot is actually, in the middle of the room is a big map that was drawn for the king, for the Sun King. And the map is both sided. You can read it from this side, the English, the language and the alphabet can be read from this side. But once you cross over, it changes and you can read it from the other side. This room is going to have all the peoples that touched Goa. We'll have one object represented from every person or every people that came to Goa. From the Arabs that came to by sea and settled in a village near Kolwali called Arabo, which Nidhi Naik, she's there, yeah. Nidhi Naik has researched, and we are very lucky. There's a banner in that village, and the Iraqis, before leaving the village at the time of the Inquisition, they gave this banner and the house, it's a big house, to the Naiks. And they said, "You all look after this banner, and every year there's an Urus, right?" And this Urus is dedicated to a saint, where they still have his grave, and they chain the chadar, or the covering sheet, on the grave every year, happening sometime in the month of February. Now, those were just the Arabs. We had everybody here. We had Armenians, we had Greeks, we had Romans, we had, which I didn't know recently, we had people that were horse traders who are now Christian, from Petra, and they're called Petu, and they live in Santines. They have a vada called Petu. So every month we keep learning of new people that came in, and they are all going to be represented in this gallery. Next, please. This is the Greek statue, the head of Neptune that we have, next, and a Roman foot, next, and a Khoja turban. This is all pre the Portuguese coming to Goa. So everybody's surprised that we had a Syrian Catholic Church, we had the Jews, we have a beautiful, very old 16th or maybe even 15th century menorah that is very heavy and made of a special brass alloy. We have them all in this room. Next, please. We also have underwear. Can you believe that is a Deccani royal underwear? Is Rana here? No, Rana, she's not here. But she will tell you more about it because she is going to tell me that they actually wore this thing under a shorter gharara, sharara, whatever it is. But we also have attached to that nada, we have a beautiful ivory threader which goes through the waistband of this beautiful piece. Next, please. Then we come to the Portuguese. Of course, now I think most Goans know about what happened with the Portuguese. They came to us in 1510. St. Francis Xavier petitioned the Inquisition in around 1540, and by 1560 we had the Inquisition here, and which changed a lot of lives, which converted me from Hindu to Catholic, and which converted, today in my house I have all the gods, and everybody says, the Catholics say, why do you have these Hindu gods? And I say, because I was Hindu 400 years ago, not a long time. This actually brings into the fact that, next slide. So that is Vasco da Gama. We have, because of Ditti Shashidharan and Percival Naronia, we have every single viceroy that came to Goa. And they are going to be all around you, from the ceiling to the side walls. And we are going to blow them up digitally and put them all up. We are also, next slide please, we are going to talk about the Inquisition in that room, where we have sketches that were done on the Inquisition. The poor unfortunates were sent to their pyres, almost they were burnt in the autos de fe, and we will show you what they made them, where to go into the fires when they killed them. They were mainly Jews and Muslims and a few Catholics that were not conforming to the new religion that they made us part of. Next, please. Then we also have garments like this that we were forced to wear. You know, they banned Indian garments. They wanted to change us as a hybrid people. They wanted to create a new hybrid people in Goa. There are so many edicts in the Inquisition that deal only with clothing. They did not want us to wear saris and cholis. They did not want us to wear pudwears. You could not enter the city of Panjim if you were wearing an Indian garment. And you were forced to wear Western garments. Those women, my grandmother, I remember, wore something like this called the ol, because she only wore saris, and until she died, she never wore a Western garment. But if they came to church, they had to cover themselves with this kind of a bedsheet called an ol or a lasol, and then go to church. Next, please. And then, most people don't realize that Goa is actually the birthplace of the Indo-Western garment. Today, we use the word Indo-Western very liberally. You know, Wendell Rodrick created minimalism and Indo-Western fusion and all this rubbish. But actually, we don't realize that the Portuguese were the first Western settlers on the coast of India. I'm using the word settlers because they reached Calicut first. But what happened? They settled here. There was no way they were going to wear those heavy velvets that they bought from Lisbon. It was not going to work in this weather and humidity. So they inherited Goa from the Bijapuri Muslims. And the Muslims bought with them the cut garment, the kurta, whatever. Writing doesn't want to hear this, but the kurta is not ours. It came from Central Asia. And they actually began to wear those lightweight clothing. We took from them stuff. We took from them petticoats. We took from them cholis, that were tight blouses, etc., which were not worn before. So what happens is that, this is a Mario Miranda illustration, we have this strange garment that is developed only in Goa in an Indo-Western way, where here is a Hindu man wearing his feto on his cap, which is a Hindu cap. He is carrying this umbrella, which was not really used much except in the Far East. He has his briefcase, so he must be working with some kind of accounts of such. I don't know what Mari has written down there. It's a city title. Okay. Then he's wearing a tie and a shirt and a jacket, but under the jacket is a pudwe. And under the pudwe are stockings or socks, which are too hot for this climate, but he wore them. And then he wore shoes. You know, Percival Naronha always told me that because he couldn't enter Panjim wearing Hindu clothes, they made them get down from their mashils, and they were young boys, they used to watch and hide behind the bushes. and look at these big bad cars that came from Diwar and from wherever to enter the city, and there they would arrive in their kashtis with a small bottle of Feeny to foster their spirits. And then they had to get out of their mashis. There they would wear these uncomfortable Western clothes. They hated the shoes because the shoes made them clumpy and look uncomfortable and felt uncomfortable. Then they would do their work in Panjim, and then they would leave, and then they would change again very happily back into their kashti. Now there are different kinds of kashtis which you will see in the region. You have white ones for the Brahmins, you have red and white ones for lower castes, etc., etc. So this room we are going to explain how the world's first Indo-Western garments are created due to a practical need in Goa. Next please. So gallery number 5 is the Christian art gallery. This is the biggest room. It soars about 9 meters up into the ceiling. It was our old altar room and dining room. And we have maintained the 280-year-old altar from Mandre church, which I happened to get at many years ago for the grand sum of 30,000 rupees. And it is up there on the wall, and Singapore Museum offered me a big amount of money to try and get that altar, but we're not letting it leave Goa. Next please. So this is the altar. Can you believe this bottom part, the door, which is about 9 feet high, is just the bottom part. So you can imagine the rest of the altar, how big it is. In this room we have church garments, we have statues, we got a beautiful donation from Gita Simoes, who pledged and gave me all the Christian art objects that she has, including about a 5.5 foot Our Lady with very long hair, lustrous hair, which is very typical to Indian art. Next please. That's a bishop's mitre which we have, studded with stones and completely in gold. Next. So these are some of the objects. This is Gita and Frank Simoes' statue. It is quite literally a little shorter than me, so it's a huge statue. And we want to find a pride of place for it. Next please. And then we have, of course, rosaries. I think we have about 5 dozen rosaries of different kinds, made of crochet, made out of wooden beads, made out of mother of pearl, like the one on the left. It is made out of shinanios. Can you imagine? From the end, from the lip of the shinanio, they carved these beads and they made them into this wonderful rosary. This is a gold rosary and that's a silver rosary. Next please. Gallery number 6 is the Parsi contribution, illustration, tools of the trade and photographs. People very often ask what were Parsis doing here, and I'll tell you what they were doing. They were here as traders, and when they came here, they actually, one of them went back to Bombay to trade in opium, because in 1808 the British came here and found out why we were so rich, it was because of opium. So they make Bombay a free port, and the Parsi that goes there is called Jamshedji Jiji Boy. Next please. So there we have a Parsi cap. Next. And illustrations of all types that were done at the time of the Portuguese. Next. We also have tools of the trade, like for example this gentleman from the very famous shop in Panjim called Crescent Tailors. His grandson actually gave me the certificate that he got from Lisbon. And we have that, we have irons, we have scissors, we have a whole bunch of things. Next please. We have embroidery samples that were given to us by 2 donors, which they learned embroidery in school. Next. And then we have photographs. We have a whole bunch of photographs. Savia is helping us to get some more photographs of our collection. Next please. And next. I got into a lot of trouble for this photograph because the family, who we know now who they are, called up and said, "Where is all this gold?" I said, "I don't know, I just got gold." I wish I got the gold for the museum. Gallery 7, we have a visual store, and here the Ministry of Textiles has assured us that they give us every single sari textile embroidery that exists in the country, because we want Goans to learn the names of all the various saris and the embroideries that exist in India. We want foreigners to learn the same. Next please. So we have old clothes like this. This is the 1930s dress, in perfect mint condition. You can wear it today. Next. Old saris that came to us. This was a sari that was worn by a bride from Karnataka in Goa. Next. And then we have a handkerchief, for example, done in Lucknowi chicken work, like my kurta. Next. Gallery number 8 are the accessories. We have some fabulous pieces here. Next, please. This shoe was worn by a Catholic lady who got married, Catholic Goan lady who got married in Karachi. And she actually saved, she's about 100 years now, she lives in Chembur in Bombay. And she gave me her entire bridal gown made of tussar silk and the shoes that were made in Austria for her wedding. Next. I have donated some of my shoes also. Next. And we have a beautiful Chinese parasol made of ivory. The handle is completely out of ivory. It's got aquamarine stones at the bottom. Next, please. And we have rare handkerchiefs like this single-headed eagle. Next. And very old shawls that came from Manila and from Spain called mantons. Next. Now, we got all this photographed. Fortunately for us, we got it all photographed by two schools in Goa. One is the One School Goa, thank you Shantanu Shiori, and the other is the Sanjay Shetty School of Film and Media. Between the two of them, we got them to photograph the entire archive, because if a foreign museum asks for a photograph, we can give it to them at a small price. Next, so that's an Indian turban. Next one is the sala or rite of passage. It's a huge room on top. Next. This is the ivory gown that was worn by the lady who owned the shoes from Vienna. And it also has a cloak, because she made this cloak, so when she was going in a horse carriage to church, if it got dusty, she then removed the cloak and entered the church with the dress. Next, please. This is given by Anita Dunan, somewhere here. Her father would use this kind of sandalwood ash paste before and after his prayers. So we have these kind of accessories. Next, please. And then we have beautiful vanity cases all in silver, which were given as a dowry to the new bride when she went to her house. We have about 4 sets of these. One is in ivory and one is in mother of pearl. One is in tortoiseshell. Very rare. I don't know how we got it. Next. I know how we got it. Sorry, Daniel. We have old dowry boxes. We have many kinds of dowry boxes where they went to give different things when they gave the dowry. The cash box is the smallest and then the clothes box is the biggest. Next. And then on top, hanging as a chandelier. This is from one of my collections. We had a big lamp, a big skirt made out of stainless steel. And we actually had the it's going to hang as a lamp now. So nobody's going to wear that stainless steel skirt again in their life. Next. The next thing is called migration. Next slide, please. This is the story about the Panbaju, which actually Mario Miranda put me onto. Next slide, please. Has anyone seen the Panbaju? I think last year Serendipity we showed it, how it is. Next. We got a beautiful Chinese mother of pearl fan with lace that came to us from Calcutta. Next. And then a lady called Hara Santana Rodriguez from Lisbon donated us this Panbaju blouse. Her mother got married in a Panbaju. And we had to ask the help of the Fundação Orient. Thank you for sponsoring my trip to Lisbon in the first place, I don't know, 20 years ago. And also then for carrying this garment that we had to bring it back to Goa. It has a jacket, the skirt and everything. Next. And in that room is an opium bed, a Chinese opium bed. We learn in this room about how the Chinese came to Goa and they bought stuff with them in the 17th or 16th century. Next, please. The next room is called Freedom, where we celebrate the freedom movement for Goa. Next. So these are Rani soldiers. Can you imagine? The Portuguese were all in their armory and these guys were taking the Mickey out of them in almost naked clothes. Next slide. And we have a beautiful portrait of Shivaji, who also gave the Portuguese in a brief. Next. This is Barino Monteiro from Lutoli. He said, I am not going to go to Panjim in a jacket and look like a penguin. I am going, if they allow this priest to go into Panjim, because the Indian garments are banned, right? I am going to wear a tunica. And he designed this tunica to protest. And the Portuguese could not stop him. He went and did his work. He insisted when he died, his daughter Nandita, Nandita got me this photograph in the end, because I heard the story from Mario Miranda. he actually insisted, I will die and be buried in my tunica. So we have a copy of the tunica in the museum. Next, please. And then we have various armories. This is something I had to learn. A boy, a Goan boy from Bombay is helping me with this. Next, please. Swords. I didn't know anything. There were markings on the sword that showed how many battles it fought. There are three markings, so it fought three battles. Which clan it came from? The curve is so the sword is curved so that when it's pierced into the body, you have a air tunnel for the blood and the air to come out, so it doesn't get stuck there. All these kind of details, I had no idea. But if you see Shivaji portraits, you will actually see this kind of a sword in his hand. It has a little top which has fallen off this sword. Next. And this is a curved sword. Next. The next dedicated to festivals. Next, please. So these are all the festivals of Goa, from the Kodimonis to the Shigmos to everything. Next, please. These are worn in Shigmo. We have this costume that were donated to us. Next. And these are all the Shigmo paraphernalia. We have all these photographs. The next is a Goan celebration room. Here we are celebrating all the tribals and all the Goans who were famous, who actually made a name for themselves. Next, please. So we have Kunbi Saris. Next. We have Chabadiyo Chappals, which are woven from the bark of a tree which collects water and is used by the Kunbi tribals. They are made out of wood and hemp. Next. Lisa Ray in my version of Kunbi Sari. Next. Has anyone seen this man before? This man is called Atmaram Shinde. He ended up being he was from Mapsa. He ended up being the chief jeweler of Harry Winston in New York. Next slide. He made jewels like that, which the Western world never saw, where you can hardly see the metal and you only see the stones. Next, please. Including that tiara and necklace for the Queen of England. Next. And the Rita Faria, two weeks ago, donated her swimsuit and all her sashes, Miss Bombay, Miss India, and Miss World to us as the first Asian, never mind first Indian, to win Miss World. She also gave us shoes, but she said that she never wore after that because her husband is a bit shorter than her. Next. We have a garment from Remo, we have a jacket. Next. And then we have my ex-assistant, Savio John. We have one garment from him and a photograph. So these are all the Goans that we have. We have this Tambol shawl from the Dangar tribe. Made of goat hair. Next. And then we have on the topmost floor a space for temporary exhibitions. Next, please. We start with the modern bride of India, where we're going to get the garments for 3 months, which I'll keep them and display them. We have the modern bride, so we get Anushka Sharma and Deepika. Next, please. And next. And next. One. Okay. I'm going to finish off in 5 minutes. Then we have the most important room, which gave us all the grief in the world possible, the gold room. We collected a lot of gold objects. We did not know we had to seal the room, ceiling, floor, and all the walls, so nobody could penetrate it with a metal mesh, and order a bank vault door to open and close this room every day so that we can ensure that all the gold objects are kept safe. Next, please. So that is a very old cross owned by the abbess of the Santa Monica convent, who made another replica for her sister who joined the convent later. It's very unusual because even if she bent down, the cloth spins, the cross spins on both sides of the same engraving in filigree. It's a huge cross. Next, please. A very old set of bangles in 24 karat pure gold with spinels, which are like rubies but not rubies. Next. And then this came from Africa, Goans who went to Africa. These are ebony beads mixed with gold. Very rare pieces. Next. And of course, a normal Goan jewelry which you still see till today. Next. This is a morni for a hair ornament which is lying with, I think, Damodar Naik in Margao. Next, please. And then illustrations of all the gold, because even the jewelers today have forgotten about all the gold that they used to make, because nobody wears this kind of jewelry anymore. Next, please. So we have illustrated all the name with the name so that people can learn and young students can learn what the jewelry was about Goa. Next, please. And then finally, we have a library. I have over 1,000 odd books which I've been collecting. Definitely the most precious and extensive library. I have one of the books that cost about 50,000, which contains every single swatch of khadi in that book. And now it's out of stock. Next, please. So that's part of my library. Next. And these are the books that I wrote, but next, please. And the books I wrote for other publications, which are all, we have every single book on Goa, and every single book on fashion designers, Indian textile, foreign textiles. It's a vast quantity of books, so they can come and do research there. Next, please. So that's how the new museum will eventually look. Time is slow, thank you very much. Completely different from the earlier house that you saw when we started the slides. Next, please. So the Moda Goa Museum and Research Center Phase 2, next. It's that part which has to be constructed as yet. Next, please. That was the logo that we designed. It's actually a woven trellis, based on a woven trellis, next. And then we have some people who have been buying up the galleries. So that's, their names will come in that gallery. You can buy a gallery and donate it in the name of a loved one. It costs anything between 25 lakhs to 40 lakhs. Or 50, I have no idea. Okay, next slide. So this is what our museum is about. We hope to open in the summer or spring of 2019. And we invite you all to partake in it. We invite you to tell people about it. We still need 3.5 crores to complete phase one. So I'm out of my begging bowl. And if anyone can help us, we'll be happy to accept your generosity. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Wendell. Another big happy for Wendell Rodrick. And this wonderful project. As a paucity of fine institutions, despite its fantastic legacy and culture, we have the greatest 20th century artists and we don't have a museum for them. We have many, many creations, we don't have a museum for them. A huge commendation to Wendell Rodrick, who is creating the first costume museum in India and based around the marvelous history and trajectory of Goan costume. Thank you, Wendell. Congratulations. For the opening, congratulations to Jerome also, I know was a big part of it. And yes.
Thank you.